We're going to go ahead and get started to be respectful of everyone's time. My name is Francisco Garcia. I'm the director of the Pima County Health Department. Today I will be acting as your facilitator for the meeting today. I don't have a standing role with this committee, with this advisory committee, but I thought that since we're completely new, it would be helpful to have me here as a facilitator to just kick things off and then let you guys sort of do your work. So the first thing that we'll have is the roll call. And Mike Schleter, could you do the roll call for us?
Ms. Barrett?
Present.
Ms. Droopy? And if I'm mispronouncing anybody's name, please correct me. Mr. Ekstrom?
Here.
Mr. Gillespie?
Here.
Dr. Hay? Ms. Hollinger? Ms. Hubbard?
Present.
Mr. Ocaño?
Here.
Dr. O'Donnell? Ms. Pena? Dr. Smith?
Here.
And Mr. Squire?
We have a quorum.
Yes, we did. So under our old bylaws, a quorum is 5 voting members, and we have 6. So we are fine to move forward. I'm going to ask my friend and former mayor of South Tucson and colleague, Mr. Dan Ekstrom, to lead us in the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Dan. Well, I'm really excited to be here. I'm really excited to be here for a couple of reasons. The transformation at PAC has been a work in progress for many years. And we have the previous advisory committee to thank for really midwifing our organization into a modern organization, and I think they deserve a ton of credit. And we are, as we enter into this new era, one of the things that we talked about was the need for a new set of eyes at the table, a new set of opinions around our discussions, and perhaps a new role for the advisory committee. All of you were selected by, each of you were selected individually by our members of the Board of Supervisors, by Mr. Chuck Huckleberry, or by your respective organizations to reflect different perspectives. So Dr. Smith from the Board of Health, her job is to help contextualize the stuff that PAC does within the context, broader context of public health, and to help the Board of Health understand how important PAC is, for instance. But each of you serves a kind of a unique and different perspective. Ms. Hollinger is the official representative from our volunteers, but I'm proud to say that there are actually other volunteer voices at the table. So I think that that's supremely important. Of course, the Humane Society and Friends of PAC are also represented. Today, not joining us are Supervisor Carroll's appointee or Supervisor Valadez's appointee. I'm trying to think of who else is missing today. Oh, the representative of the City of Tucson, who was selected to represent the five jurisdictional partners who help pay our bills at PAC. So they will be joining us, and they are definitely interested. I believe that Mr. Carroll is in the process of identifying an alternate to Dr. Hay, because I think there was a potential conflict in terms of scheduling, permanent conflict and other issues. So I know that he's in the process of selecting a new person. I'd like to take the first item that we have, item number 3, which is the introduction of the committee members. And I don't like putting people on the spot, but I think it's kind of important for you to introduce yourselves to each other and to talk about the perspectives that you are bringing to the table. And I'm hoping that some people volunteer to be the first one. Thank you, Pat. And then Dr. Smith, you will go around.
Everybody, my name is Pat Hubbard, and I've been working for the Humane Society of Southern Arizona for the last 27 years. With the Humane Society going off the community, I was asked to serve as a representative for Sharon Bronson in District 3. I'm fluent in animal welfare. If you want to know something about animal welfare, I can help you. And I also have an outreach in the community, which is what I do now, I do community outreach and education. So I get to go to lots of meetings and meet lots of people. And finally, just say, the county, thanks to the county and their funding, our community has dropped like 14% of the population that's going into our shelters. So this figure has worked. I'm just saying that so they keep giving us money.
That for me. My name is Dan Smith. I'm a retired gynecologist, and I'm the appointee for the Board of Health. I've been on the Board of Health for 4 years, and I've been on PAC. I think one of the important things that Dr. Garcia said is that how our animal care is connected with our Board of Health and with the health of the community is extremely important to me. I also think that how our animals are taken care of has a lot to say about the community in general. And I think it's incredible that our county has gotten the bond task to build a new animal center. And I'm just really excited about this moving forward.
My name is Christy Holliger, and I am the volunteer representative from PAC. I've been volunteering there off and on, maybe 4 years, but pretty heavily for the last 3 years or so. And my perspective is directly, you know, impacting the pets in the shelter and just, you know, the operations and how things affect the welfare of the animals. And also, you know, my perspective is to try to help increase the life release rate and save as many animals as we can that are safe to be in our community. So that's my goal.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
I'm Barry Gillespie. I'm a Tucson native, and I've been working at PAC now for about 6 years, but I really didn't get highly involved until about 3 years ago. I also volunteer. I do adoptions and off-site work with adoptions, and then I'm moving animals from spaying clinics where I'm coming back to PAC. I've been involved in politics in the community. I used to be a Pima County planner many years ago. I was vice mayor of Will Valley, and I finished, you know, my career at Pima Community College. But I think, in terms of my perspective, one thing I've learned is that our community health is really tied to animal welfare and health. They're very closely related in terms of how we interact with people in the community. And I would like to see us continuing towards a no-kill shelter at Pima County. I think it would be a feather in this community's cap, and it's something that I think we can achieve. And so that's what I hope to bring forward.
Hi, my name is Tammy Berry, and I am the chair for Friends of PAC. Our mission is to solely support the animals at Pima Animal Care for medical needs. And other such things that we need to help PAC get what they need through fundraising efforts.
Well, my name is Mike Schleter. I'm not a member of the committee, I'm the coordinator. So I'm the one that's sent out a lot of emails and stuff. And so feel free to contact me. I'm here to facilitate.
And I'm Francisco Garcia. Part of the portfolio responsibilities that I have as director of the health department, a fairly significant part of the portfolio of responsibilities that I have, is as the appointing authority and the oversight for PAC. I do that with a very competent team. I do that with the tremendous support of volunteers who help us keep our doors open every day, and with partner agencies, many of which are around the table and in the audience, that help us to meet our goals. And part of my job is to try to balance what is what is desirable with the resources that we have and how to marry both of those to each other. And then somebody asked me today if I was a, somebody asked me today if I was a animal person, and I said, well, I am now. Honestly, I had not had a pet since my childhood. Now, of course, I have two shelter cats and one shelter dog, and I'm very happy to have them in my family.
My name is Dan Ekstrom. I'm a retired but recovering politician. I served in political office as Garcia mentioned, first as a member of the city council and the mayor of South Houston, and I served 4 terms on the Pima County Board of Supervisors before I retired. And I'm not sure what I'm doing here. Supervisor Richard Diaz called me up and he got me in a moment of weakness. But then I heard that Pat was here and we worked together and I seen Tamara and some of the things over that they do in the community. And so I have a little experience in terms of not necessarily being out there volunteering like the rest of you do, but in terms of working at a different level, and maybe I can be helpful in the perspective of you know, people that have to make political decisions. We can always try to influence them. You can probably do a better job than I can, but there may be some things like that. And the only other thing that I really can say that I was involved in was I was actually the guy that I was paid to run the campaign proposition. The community hired me, and we put together the strategy and all that stuff and worked together with other people to make it happen. And it was really all the volunteers that made it happen. I was just lucky.
We are thankful you're at the table. Yeah.
My name is Jose Ocaño. I'm one of the division leaders at PAC, holding the agency with Justin Gellick. I've worked there for 10 years. I started off as a kennel tech, and I now oversee our operation, and I'm super happy to be here.
We had one of our new members join us a little bit late, and we are going around the table introducing ourselves. We were talking about how, in many ways, this is a sort of a kickoff for a new era in PAC that the previous advisory committee has midwifed into existence, but now it's our turn to carry the ball across the end zone. And one of the new representatives around the table is yourself, and I wanted you to hopefully talk about who you are, but also the perspective that you are tasked with bringing to this
committee. Sure, thank you. So I'm Andy Squire. I am a economic development specialist working for the city manager in the city of Tucson. I have a long history, a great respect for Mr. Ekstrom at the table. I haven't seen him in a bunch of years, so it's a pleasure seeing you again, sir. I worked both with and against Mr. Ekstrom. When I worked, he was my boss, but at the time, I didn't have a choice. We didn't win those, honestly. Mr. Ekstrom was far better at that. But I worked for City Councilmember Fred Ronstadt, and then also for City Councilmember Shirley Scott. And I am a pragmatist. I believe in getting things done. I work for Republicans and for Democrats. I've enjoyed even more having the opportunity to work for the city manager and kind of leaving the political piece of it behind, and to the extent that you can, and really working to get things done for the community. So I was brought in to initially work on our gem show issues that we had at the TCC, the lack of customer service there. Worked with the team there to privatize that and actually repair our reputation there. I have worked on the economic development team now with some great successes, partnering with the county, the city, Suncor Inc., and the ACA on the Caterpillar project that's come in now and some other things. And one of my other wonderful tasks, which I actually really enjoy and do have a passion for, is now animal licensing. I've been working with Justin Gallup. Jose, nice to meet you. Haven't met you officially. On expanding the licensing efforts for Pima Animal Care Center in the city. The city spends a lot of money with the brunt of the budget for the Pima Animal Care Center. One of the pieces that's challenging with that is we have horrendous compliance with licensure. We're at like around 27 to 30-some percent, pretty poor. And to make it easier for constituencies, I have been asked to put that together. We just started it this week. We finally have it up and running. The additional piece that ties in with that is I am the representative now for the municipalities, is the best way to put it, for work. I have been appointed by the manager to represent the city of Tucson and less directly, Oro Valley, Sahuarita, Marana, all the partners with the county in animal services. So great opportunity to work with Dr. Garcia, to work with all of you. I have a great relationship with Humane Society as well, so have a great time with that. And looking forward to seeing what we can accomplish as we move forward. Great new times for PAC, great efforts.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. O'Donnell just joined us. She's one of our returning members, and Dr. O'Donnell, we're going around the table sort of introducing ourselves because there are many new faces, as you well know, and also many new perspectives, and to share with the rest of the team what perspective you're bringing to the table.
Okay. Hi. I apologize. I'm so sorry that I'm late. I'm Erin O'Donnell, the veterinarian and the representative of the Southern Arizona Veterinary Medical Association. And I look at things from the, obviously, the medical perspective, from the pets and challenges we might face for, such as just getting medical care to underserved populations and underserved pets, and what we as a veterinarian to the community can contribute to basically the overall health and welfare of the pets in Pima County.
Thank you, Dr. O'Donnell. I'm going to exercise the prerogative, given that I'm facilitating the meeting today, to ask Ms. Dan Lesher, our Deputy County Administrator, who's here on behalf of Mr. Chuck Buckleberry, to offer her welcome.
Thank you. Let me just welcome Dr. Garcia. Dr. Downs also my vet, so Lucy and Desi and the cats at home. Thank you. thrilled to be here, and as Dr. Garcia has mentioned, I think that we're excited about the next steps in the progress of PAC. I think we've had lots of good efforts in taking care of wonderful animals for many, many years, but recently we've gone through a lot of changes. We've got the bonds going, we've got some new facilities in the works, and so many new partners and fundraising opportunities and things, so we're just thrilled to be kicking off the next stage of the life of PAC, so thrilled to be here, and thanks to all of you for being here.
Thank you.
I'm emailing Chuck as we speak.
Thank you, Jason. Sorry to put you on the spot. If there are no other questions, I'd like to move to the next agenda item, number four. I thought one of the important things to revisit, especially because there are a lot of new faces and a lot of new perspectives at the table, is to really talk about what has been a decade's worth of progress that, as I said previously, was in some ways, in some measures, midwifed by the previous advisory committee. And to see where it is that we are starting from from that perspective. So I'm going to let my friend Mike Schlieder make things happen.
Okay.
During the last 10 years, we've made some incredible progress at PAC on a lot of different fronts. But in particular, I would say during the last 3 years, there have been some big events that have been relatively transformational. And part of that effort, I would like to make sure that we can share with you today.
Hello, we're here.
So I'm going to ask my friend and colleague, Mr. Jose Ocaño, who is our co-leader. Right now at PAC, we have essentially a dual kind of leadership structure where Jose is in charge of one set of responsibilities and aspects of the agency, and Justin is in charge of another component. Jose being on a newly appointed member to this committee, Mr. Huckleberry's appointments to this committee, I thought it was important for him to be able to share that with you. And I'm hoping that Tammy and Pat and Dr. O'Donnell, Dr. Smith can sort of chime in because I think their fingerprints are on this too.
Good evening, everybody. This is always exciting for me to talk about because I lived this. Much of what we'll see has not been the easiest of roads, but it's really, that's what makes it so satisfying, all the successes that we've collectively had. It really is a collective effort to move this organization from, you know, an entity and an agency that really where a lot of animals went to die to a place where animals go and are rehabilitated and have a second shot at life. Let's see. So just some, you know, basic information. The facility was built in 1969. We're super ready and excited for that new facility and that groundbreaking that's going to happen later this year. And one of the things that always strikes me is just how big Pima County is and the fact that we, along with Community Society, there's two shelters. You know, in other communities our size, there's lots of other shelters. So we do a really, I think, incredible job, and that's also because of our community. Our community is also, I think, a very progressive community, and that's why we're able to be a progressive animal shelter. Just some basic, our basic budget information, which I know throughout the committee we'll probably have specific presentations on budget. And so we have about 91 employees and take in 20,000 live animals a year. So in 2007, we were taking in about 22,000 animals. And you'll see throughout this presentation why I reference Humane Society, because there's always a correlation. Whenever we do something different, it affects Humane Society. When they do something different, it affects us. So at this time, Humane Society was open admission. And I know we have some new folks in here who aren't animal welfare oriented maybe necessarily. So open admission means that they take in every animal that comes to their front door. There's other types of shelters where, and operations where you can manage your intake and you have to pay a fee or you have to wait for your appointment. And those are actually best practices, and we'll talk a little bit later about PAC's plans to implement some of those. Our live release rate, so basically the easiest way, simplest way to talk about that is it's the amount of animals coming alive that leave alive, 39%. And so that is something that is no longer acceptable for us, but that just kind of shows where we were. And one of the reasons why historically that live release rate was so low was because we had a pit bull policy, and that policy was any pit bull over the age of 3 or 4 months was automatically euthanized. In 2007, one of the great things that happened was we changed that. We decided that that was no longer an acceptable thing, that we should not be putting age requirements of a specific breed and determining their fate solely based on that. So we'll later see how in 2008, some stuff changed. The live release rate changed to 44%, but intake even increased. In theory, you have more animals, you would think more animals would still be dying. But because that pit bull policy changed, that's what allowed us to save more. In 2008, something else that happened is we finally had a dedicated position to focus on triaging and treating animals that were coming in sick. Before, when I first started in the shelter, it was you clean cat room, you intook animals, or you euthanize. And so there was this really key missing component of we need someone who can just triage. And then we were doing really, really minimal, if any, treatment. But at least it was the start of our medical program. And that's when the culture started to shift, that just change in philosophy of let's create a position that's actually going to help animals and save them and not put them to sleep. 2009, and so that's Justin. I come to him like this all the time, and in that hat.
That's true.
Okay. So Justin, historically, I believe he worked 10 years at the Humane Society. It was a really long time.
And you stole
this. We, stealing of Humane Society employees is a trend you'll see. You know, and people like that. The thing, when Justin came on, he came in with a lot of different perspective, that Humane Society perspective. When I was at the shelter, I remember my colleagues at the time saying, we're not the Humane Society, that's not who we are. As though saving animals, educating the public was a bad thing. We are animal control. And I always was never really understood what does that mean. So when Justin came in the position of animal care advocate, that really changed everything. The cultural shift, kind of the fast forward button, was pressed. And it was met with a lot of resistance because because I think sometimes when you come in and say there's a different way to do this, people hear, I've been doing this wrong. And especially when that is correlated to life and death decisions, which there's a lot of shame correlated to that, it was really understandable that I saw people being really resistant to some of those changes. One of the things we created was a rescue coordinator position. And I was lucky enough to actually be the first rescue coordinator that we had at PAC. At the time, when that first started, we worked with about five or six different rescue organizations. That's Brandon and Tammy, and we became close friends.
We did a lot together.
And I mean, those are the old school days of, you know, someone in management or the veterinary team would throw a stack of 50 cards, and these animals need to be out by today. And you were just making phone calls to people and writing on kennel cards and trying to coordinate it. So one of the first things we did is we wanted to standardize a rescue program and make it easy for new rescue partners to come on and streamline the process of getting these animals into the rescue organizations. So it grew from 500 animals to 2,000 animals in that first year just by simply having a process for people who wanted to help you to be able to help you. And then we started the caveat program, which was the special needs adoption program. This program still is a pillar program at PAC. Because the philosophies initially were the only people who can take these animals are the rescues. So if you came, for instance, and was like, I want to help this animal, and I will take it to my vet. It was, you're the public, I can't trust that you're going to do those things. So you're going to need to go through a rescue organization. They're volunteers and inundated. And the time lapse between that often meant that these animals were dying. So we decided, why can't we place faith into community members and that they're going to do the right thing and that they're going to treat the animals? And we'll have checks and balances. We'll have a whole process where they have to fill out a form and they're going to have to send it in and we'll verify it. If not, we'll send an animal care officer out. And so it was met with a lot of resistance, but it actually was a program that was really successful, and it kind of validated my belief that people are inherently good and they want to do the right thing, which in this animal welfare field, it's not the common kind of thought. I hear a lot, I work with animals because I hate people. But in animal welfare, in terms of community shelters, that kind of mentality can be detrimental for you placing animals, because if you hate people, people are your donors, people are your adopters, people are your other clients, people and animals. And so I was recently at the Best Friends Conference, and the CEO of Best Friends really honed in on that shift of animal welfare professionals embracing that human component. So in 2010, we opened the doors to our new, we call it Harry's Haven now, but it is the base of indoor-outdoor kennels. There was a bond. So they put up new kennel lane that is much better. We'll see a lot of similar type kennel lane in the new facility. And they redid the air exchange system. They made the drains more efficient for disease control. And so that was really, really great. When the Humane Society starts to become more closed admissions, because again, a Humane Society doesn't have a budget off the bat. They have to, their budget and their operation is determined by how much donations they got the year before or several years back. So they started to be more perhaps selective, I don't know if that's the right word, of the animals they're taking in. So of course, people are going to come to PAC. So that's why you see this spike in our
limits, probably.
Limit. I was like, what's the moral to this thing? Yeah. And our wide release rate is still in the 40s. At that time, that's when we started an inmate program. Historically, the same staff who would come in and do intake and clean the cat rooms and all that, they were also in charge of cleaning the whole shelter. So because of that, animals, dogs specifically, were being sprayed in their kennels, bleach sometimes on animals. It was just a really inhumane, ineffective way of cleaning. So we brought on board an inmate program so that we could start the most basic thing. And these are huge wins for us, like take the dog out of the kennel to clean. It sounds like, how have you not ever done that? But it wasn't done. So the inmate program was a game changer for the humane way of actually just cleaning a kennel. And then we actually started to treat upper respiratory infection. You or I, for many years when I worked at PAC, was a death sentence. You sneezed, and I mean, where the staff would never say that they heard or saw a dog sneezing or a cat sneezing. So we started to treat, we kind of had a designated area, and we started to treat the animals. It was only for a short period of time. The rescues would have 48 hours, 72 hours. They weren't getting a full treatment course, but it was a win because we were doing something. You're giving animals an extra few days. And that's when we started, when Justin was now here his first year, and we started. So the subtext of assembling the right team is more Humane Society staff. And something that we was not on this presentation, the last time I gave this to the advisory committee, was the launch of Pack Pets in B2. That was fundamentally huge. It changed the way we market our animals. It provided a platform for people who couldn't come to the shelter to see an animal, and our adoptions really increased. And that was completely facilitated by a volunteer named colleague Kelly Constock. And I, many years ago, it was just an email that she would send me a list of animals, and I would send her like the status of the animal. So I mean, it's come a long way. The Pack Pets Need You, now there's Pack Cats Need You, and there's lots of other, you know, sister Facebook pages that are really helpful. In 2011, our live release goes up a little bit, our intake goes down. We get a grant from the Pet Finder Foundation for a Train to Adopt program. And so it was our first kind of attempt at doing some behavior modification. The program, the grant actually wasn't repeated because I don't think we were ready. We weren't ready yet to start tackling behavior. We are just about to be ready now. So this was many, many years ago. In 2012 is when we'll start, 2012 to now, we'll start to see some significant increases. You know, what were we before? 55 to 64, that's a pretty big spike in live release in 1 year. And we started to do lots of other things. One of the things that was really helpful through the guidance of PACAC was to increase our rescue partnerships. You know, for many, many years, animals, there was a lot of stipulations on what animals would be available to rescue. It had to sit through a Sunday. Do you remember that? It had to sit through a Sunday. It couldn't be highly adoptable, whatever that meant. And so we just said, rescue wants to come in and get an animal, let them. You know, if the Humane Society wants to come in and take whatever they want, take it. We don't have the space, we don't have the resources. They can take whatever animals they want. So that was really helpful. And then we started the holiday box, which when I first heard about what a holiday box was, I thought it was the worst idea in the world. And it was one of the many times I've been wrong. It was whenever you're gonna have hundreds of people show up and you're not gonna know them, and not have any training, and you're gonna give them a dog, and they're gonna go to the park, and they're gonna, that, I was like, no, that won't work. And it really does work. And what it did was, it allowed for community members who never maybe came to the shelter, they didn't know what it was, or they thought they had a completely different idea of what the shelter was. So from that moment, we started to get much more interest, public interest, more interest in donations, more interest in volunteering, and overall just public awareness, which is priceless. Those holiday walks, we're having one on Labor Day, I think. It's the next one. So 2013 again, so what was it? So 64 to 76, again, huge jump in that live release rate. I remember when we hit the 70s, we were shocked. We never thought we would hit the 70s that quickly, and our intake starts to go lower. We, through the holiday walks and seeing that people really wanted help, we realized we needed to create a volunteer coordinator position so that we made the process easier for people to come and volunteer. Volunteers completely were a game changer with the volunteer program. When I started in the volunteer coordinator role, we had about 100 volunteers, and in the first year, it was in the hundreds and hundreds of volunteers. And it was just about making a really easy process for people to come and help animals. And we also wanted to put more emphasis on an adoption program, so we created an adoption coordinator position and we restructured the whole program. I think adoptions program is one of those things that we will continue to see evolve as it needs to as the times change. And we've got a contract with Pima Paws for Life where we would send the animals off-site to get complete URI treatment. That contract hasn't been renewed because we found more creative ways to utilize some of the funding that we have. But for the time being, it was a really critical piece in not having so many animals that were sick with kennel cough at Pima Paws for Life still continues to be a great rescue partner and pull animals from us. So 2014 to me is like the year where really things start to change. At the time, the live release rate is 78%. As you can see, not a whole lot. We hit plateaued, so we knew something fundamentally needs to change if we want to see greater strides. At that time, so intake went down slightly. There's not a whole lot of difference from the year before. But that is when we were so overcrowded. And the reason we wrote Priority is we hired on Dr. Wilcox, which to me was one of the best things, because we actually were able to start a full-on shelter medical program.
You're welcome.
Thank you again. So, but one of the things that I never thought of was, you're going to save all these animals, where are they going to go? You're not putting any extra money into marketing, you're not necessarily having more staffing and adoptions, or even putting more of an emphasis on your adoption program on a volunteer basis. So we got very overcrowded very, very fast, because we no longer thought it was acceptable to euthanize for space. And so there was this whole, I don't even know what to call it, there was a proclamation through the Board of Supervisors where they granted us, you know, funding to put up this tent. Many of us here know that the tent is a point of contention for some people. We, Chrissy and I, have lived through many things, but it has saved and continues to save thousands of animals' lives. I don't know what we would do if we didn't have an extra 98 kennels that house at any given time 200 animals. We need the tent. And it actually, I think, ended up being a great kind of visual for why we needed a new shelter. So I think in the big picture, the tent has been very, very helpful. Through the whole initiative of the tent, we also got funding for 6 additional animal care technicians, a dedicated shelter manager with Dr. Wilcox, a foster coordinator, and a development director. I think the development director, I never even realized at the time that that was cutting edge. It is still cutting edge. There are not municipal shelters who have development directors, because they're under the impression that you can't fundraise, and or people won't want to fundraise. When Karen presented this year at the Best Friends Conference, people were really shocked that not only do we have one, but of the success of the program. This program has allowed us to launch so many other life-saving programs that have been instrumental in saving animals at PAC. Throughout 2014, lots of great things will happen. With the help of PAC Act, the community spay-neuter fund increased to $600,000, as Pat talked about earlier. Community spay-neuter is a really key pillar in our community to decreasing the amount of animals that are coming through our shelters. We also started a process called reservations, or pre-adoption, where people can come in and decide that they want an animal before it was available, and kind of put a placeholder. Again, that is something that's now recommended by Tora at UC Davis. At the time, we had no idea that that was a kind of cutting-edge idea with policies in the shelter. And then we started to pre-alter all of our animals. Historically, when you adopt an animal, you go to the clinic and get altered. But we found that a lot of people weren't adopting because they wanted to take an animal home right then and there. And so that, you know, that's how our society is. I want it now. And so I think it behooves us to kind of accommodate that. So we started to pre-alter animals as best we can, and they can go home. And that has really helped our adoption process. Historically, in regards to owner requests and euthanasias, there was kind of like a no-ask policy. Like, if you came in and wanted to euthanize your animal, you could. That animal could be bouncing off the walls, completely looks healthy, not showing any signs of aggression, but because you requested it, we would proceed. And we looked at that and said, that's not okay. We are not a place that wants to do what we think sometimes are convenient euthanasias. And so, from 2014, we created kind of a clause when people sign over their animal saying that we reserve the right to evaluate the animal and determine whether or not what we're going to do. The reality is the vast majority of people, when they come in and request euthanasia, get it. Because people really do know their animals, but many, many animals are saved because we now at least have the checks and balances with this process. And with, where is Marcy back here? Marcy Bellin, I put it in. That year,
oh, yeah, on the previous page.
Yeah. Was it?
Yeah. Oh, so good. Now you put it in twice.
You're
telling. Very good. You well, deserve it.
I
very
expect
good.
My edible arrangement soon. So, I like white chocolate. So with Noble Pima County, one of which I think has been a really important partnership that PAC has now, and especially was in these pivotal years, it was PAC really just said yes, we can have it. Marcy and her team really did the majority of the legwork and facilitated it. It was a help desk, which is where people come to PAC to surrender an animal, and they are there with resources and options trying to help people to kind of prevent a shelter intake. And they were very, very successful. And because of the success of that program, we'll see later on other programs that have launched. And I don't think if we never started this, we wouldn't have some of the programs we have now and are about to launch later this year. for many, many years, it was told that FIV positive cats are not adoptable. They should be euthanized. They should not even be co-housed. And so a lot of literature came and said, you know, if they're asymptomatic, they can be adopted. They should be adopted. And so when we started to change just some of our policies and our restrictions on what we place up for adoptions, we started to see an increase in live release rate. And then in 2014, one of the most important, I think, partnerships we continue to have is with Best Friends Animal Society. We were asked to fill out a grant, which is always a really good sign, when they say, you should really fill this out for a community cat project. And the grant is well over $1 million, and it's in partnership with PetSmart Charities, which is, again, an amazing foundation that historically we didn't work a lot with. Now, we rely on our partnership with them to move our progressive agenda forward. And so because historically, a feral cat or anything that came in as feral, which means it just had to look unfriendly or act unfriendly, which cats, after being in a car and now walking through a shelter full of dogs, and they get like a 5-second evaluation, they were getting very unfair evaluations. But nonetheless, our shelter was so very overcrowded. So with this community cat project, which is also basically a trap neuter return and shelter neuter return, this is actually what has aided us to have over 90% live release rate for cats, and it happened really, really fast. And because of our success with the program, we've been eligible to gain other grants and other partnership opportunities with Best Friends. And of course, there's Prop 415.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. There were so many people on the committee who were really involved in that. As someone who worked at PAC, you know, 10 years ago, when I found out we won, like, it was so emotional, I think, for many of us, because it was just, you can do so much, but working in that building and against it all the time is sometimes very discouraging, and it's very difficult. So to know that we're going to have a building that is geared towards life savings is a true game changer, and I can't wait to open doors. In 2015, we hit a 90-plus live release rate, which nationally is considered a no-kill metric, which was really incredible and such a testament to the community and all these different stakeholders coming together to help us. And our intake dropped. I never just look at in our live release rate. To me, is a true staple of if your shelter is successful is, are you decreasing intake? Are you keeping these animals in their homes? Are you preventing animals from being born through spay-neuter efforts? So it's really great to see that number, and I hope to see that number continue to go down. The other program we started was the decompression program that was started by, again, a group of volunteers. One of the things that I always have to remember as a shelter leader is my job sometimes is just to say yes. I do not always have the resources or the staffing to start a program, but we have amazing, dedicated volunteers who say, if you let me do this, we will facilitate it, we will buy our own stuff, we will be, you know, the guardian of this program. The decompression program is a great example. What it was dogs that were really shy and skittish who were being euthanized. So it's a subset of those animals that they work with through enrichment and through training, and they are greatly successful. And so many hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, I don't know if we're in the thousands yet.
Over 1,000 and how many have been through the program?
Have been so successful. Program, and so we hope to continue to build through that with a future behavior program. We also started getting the really positive response of some donors in town and some philanthropists. Bonnie Kay, who many people may or may not know, is a really great animal advocate throughout, you know, Pima County, through every animal or agency. She gave us a grant to hire 2 full-time cat care leads because we noticed that we still weren't providing cats the kind of care they need, and they are the most stressed out animals in the entire shelter. So we now have 2 part-time staff who really focus in on providing cats the care they need. And kind of to piggyback off of the Millville Pima County Help Desk, we hired a part-time staff to help staff those efforts. And so Liz, who is the current staffer, worked very, very closely with Marcy and continues to. We got a grant from PetSmart Charities, over $100,000, to hire an offsite adoption coordinator. And so we moved into PetSmart locations for cats. That, honestly, was such a huge game changer for so many reasons. So now we have cats offsite. The PetSmart staff do the adoptions. They clean the kennels. And it opens up space in the shelter to kind of work with cats that normally you would say, can we place? I don't think so. There's not enough room to really work with this cat. So we were able, the CAC, it was kind of a really great effort between the CAC care leads and this offset adoption coordinator, because now there was room and space to help the cats, and there was staff available to actually do it. And we hired two additional full-time shelter veterinarians to have a really incredible shelter medical program, and it's been really neat to start off and see that we fought to get doxycycline pill in the dog, and now we're amputating and getting chemo and doing lots of really amazing, you know, heroic efforts to save animals. This past year, we launched our barn, our working cat program, and that again was through Bonnie Kay and with the cat care leads. With barn cat or the working cat program, we would have cats that didn't qualify for the TNR program. They weren't rehabilitatable in a shelter setting, but we still don't want euthanasia to be the outcome. And so now there are certain cats that qualify to go off and be working cats. And every situation is different. You have some cats that have never had any outdoor experience, so they may go to a distillery, and so they're still inside. And some live literally in barns. And you have others who have outdoor experience, and so they're living in just a rural area. But we try our best to be really strategic to try and make sure that we're setting up that cat for success. And again, it's one of those programs where we were doing it, and then Huffington Post came out with it. So we're always like right on the cusp of those cutting edge programs. We relaunched our foster program to kind of streamline that process. And foster, and all of our live release programs are always under redevelopment, always what can we do to be better. And we reorganized our leadership structure to have two division managers, that's me and Justin. And we broke ground, we're gonna break ground this year for our new shelter. Sometime at the end of this year, we're gonna break ground. We just completed the archaeology.
It will be in early October.
So what I think I also want to talk about is the future, because I think that's what this committee is really going to play a key part in. So we recently changed our mandatory hold times for owner surrenders to 5 days. On PACAC's recommendation, we have hired Adam, Ricky right behind me, our enforcement operations manager, because one of the things we know we need to do is really look at our enforcement and dispatch operation and find constructive ways to move that unit forward. We're really excited because I think we're in a really good place to do that. It's time. The last few years have been focused on the shelter, the clinic, our live release units, and now it's time for that other half of the house to kind of move up so that we can be a fully operational, progressive shelter. We're going to launch our pet support center within the next few months, and what that would be, and that's kind of piggybacking off again, that helped us SOS happen, and then we got the grant to have staff from Monty K. And then PetSmart Sharing says, we kind of like what you're doing here. If we gave you again over $100,000 grant, can you hire staff to do owner surrender appointments? So they're going to be doing owner surrender appointments for healthy animals, and they're also going to be giving them, hopefully, the goal is to give them options and solutions and resources and tools to keep animals from coming in. One of the things that we know from Marcy and Okotoks County, and just from other shelters' experiences, is that once someone shows up to the shelter, a lot of times they're disconnected from that animal, so it's harder to get them to change their mind. But when you can get them on the phone before they've made that decision, your success rate in keeping that animal with them or giving them options to rehome that animal themselves is much higher. So my hope is that through this, you know, we can keep more pets in their home, stabilize the amount of animals in our care. Right now, with the way it is, we can have 500 one day and 700 the next, because there's no management of the population. When you don't have the management of the population, it's really just hard to manage your operation as a whole. So this is gonna be, I think, a game changer. The second game changer program will be the behavior program. We had a trainer, she took a job to train elephants at the zoo. I mean, that's kind of an amazing job. That never comes so. She told us Friday when she was going to start Monday, but it's okay. I'm a big believer to not have what's not meant for us. So we're reposting that position, I believe, tomorrow. And we hope to launch a behavior program, because I think one of the areas we really need to focus our energy on are on large dogs. And it's not just that. Across the country, you see shelters struggling with placement of large dogs for behavior programs. So it'll be great to have a behavior a trainer and an assistant. There's going to be a full-time assistant kind of launching that program. And overall, my goal, and I think our collective goal, is to just streamline a lot of our processes and bring us into best practice. which best practice is always changing. So for us, I want to always be on the cutting edge of sheltering, and I hope you guys can help us do that.
You can see why I'm so excited, and I feel like we have made such tremendous progress, again, thanks to the good oversight of our advisory committee, with the good assistance of our advisory committee. And I believe that this is a great launching off point. I don't know if the committee has questions for Jose.
Pre-alter model, Jose. I'm just not familiar with that. What happens?
So they spear gore the animal prior to going up for an alter.
Okay, that literally like it sounds like. They get it done in advance. Okay, great.
And in the old days, that was thought not to be a smart strategy, because what if somebody didn't adopt that animal, right? Mm-hmm. And we were out the effort and supplies. But we find that it makes our animals much more adoptable.
Absolutely.
And it increases the customer satisfaction in terms of being able to lead with the pet that you want.
Yeah. And I think before, when you're utilizing 40 or 60 or 70% of your animals, it doesn't make sense. But right. Now that that's not the case, it makes total sense to, yeah. to do that.
Another question, Jose. Now that we have the new leadership at PAC, from having so many years of experience, I know what it's like to have people come to work for you who don't like people. So, no, seriously, they buy animals, they don't like people, and we all know that if you don't have the people, you don't have the animals. How have you changed that process? I mean, I know people have experience with animals, but you can teach that, but it's really hard to teach the people skills.
A lot of our emphasis on the recruitment process and through interviews, and especially the second interview, we heavily focus on the people component, because I agree, I can teach you how to restrain an animal. I can't teach you to want to work with people. And so that's something we heavily focus on. So even the customer service experience and public contact is looked at just as much, if not more, than I'm in. So it's something that is very, very important.
So that is a focus now.
Yes.
Hiring people. Other questions? I will move us on to the next item if there are no questions. So one of the key and most important tasks as we launch PAC Act 2.0 which is to enact or approve a new set of bylaws or to reaffirm the existing bylaws. The existing bylaws had a bunch of positions in them that no longer exist under the new ordinance, so it would need to be revised. Or you can start from scratch. And so we have two options that I would like to place before the committee. And in your packet, you have the existing bylaws. Mike will be also handing out another set, a draft set of just very schematic bylaws that could be used instead. It will be up to the committee to decide how it wants to move forward. In fact, the committee could start from scratch. They could say, we don't want anything that you've put forward, Francisco. We want to craft something that is completely unique and reflects our spirit, reflects our commitment, and that would be entirely acceptable. I have written bylaws by committee. I have written bylaws individually, and it's always a little bit of a challenge. What I would like to propose to the advisory committee, and I'd like you guys to sort of please engage in some discussion about this, one option might be to identify a subset of about four committee members. I'm saying four because five is a quorum, and we do not want to be in violation of the open meeting law. To identify a subset of four committee members that would, off this time, between now and the next meeting, meet maybe, or meet electronically, to come up with the bylaws that you want, and to make sure that whatever we do sort of reflects your preferences. It would be facilitated by my deputy director, Marcy Flanagan, who's great at helping people come together and is really great at process things, which I am not. And she could act as the facilitator for that, and we could, like I said, even meet in person or electronically. It just can't be the entire group for obvious open meeting law considerations. But I wanted to put that on the table for the committee and hear you discuss your preferences and provide guidance. Mr. Gillespie?
Dr. Garcia, thank you for that. I spent quite a bit of time looking at the guidelines and was prepared tonight. And I think I would support the idea of having a subcommittee to take a look at those and try to bring something back to the committee as a whole. I have one question. According to the count on the members that we have now, it looks like the new quorum would be 6.
I believe that the new quorum would be a higher number. Yeah. I think that because we are currently laboring under the existing bylaws, even though it probably would be in keeping with the spirit, I just don't want to go there. And also, we don't want to make the group too large. It's the other challenge in terms of working with folks. So that was the rationale for my thinking. But I could be challenged, certainly. Mm-hmm. Other thoughts?
I'd be happy to be a part of that as well. That's doing it that way. Bylaws can be a real struggle if you make it too specific, it really hurts getting anything done. And with the other commissions I've worked on or been on, yeah, I prefer to take a peek at it and make them as clean and simple. I mean, I'm thrilled that you put out a pre-draft. Thank you. That helps a lot.
Would it help to have someone with animal experience doing bylaws? I don't write bylaws, but I know.
Great part. We have a facilitator and they have attorneys. So...
So I've heard 3 individuals express an interest in moving forward. We're not going to take a vote because I don't want to put the committee, if you will indulge me, I don't want to put the committee in the pickle of having to vote on writing these new bylaws. And I don't believe that it actually merits it, but I would love for there to be a fourth perspective at the table.
I'd be happy to enjoy. I'm not sure I have a different perspective or not. I think
it would be terrific. I think it provides continuity. The two of you provide some continuity, and then Andy and Barry would provide a kind of fresh set of eyes. What I'm hoping that you will think about as you're writing the bylaws are what kinds of officers do you think are needed,
sure.
Not what kind of officers we've always had. Because I think that it's going to be important for this committee to think about what does it want to do as it moves into the future. And I think that part of it needs to be, part of the reason why we have this kind of new version of the advisory committee is to bring some new thinking to the table. So I would encourage, I'm not going to be part of that conversation. I don't think it's appropriate, nor do I think it's needed. You guys are the experts. But I will make sure that Marcy facilitates. Mike will transmit the names to her. And if the contact information for the folks who have volunteered to be in the bylaw subcommittee. And I will ask her in the next couple of weeks to really in earnest, and it probably will be electronic work, luckily, to start digging into what you want to do. So any other comments about bylaws, wisdom?
Well, let me just say that sometimes you can spend too much time on bylaws. Mm-hmm. And you've got to recognize that this committee is advisory. And so, you know, we're not writing the Constitution of the United States. Although you want to have a document that's flexible. So I think that if you look at that as you start the process, I think that's a good way to... And the other thing, too, is that you got to remember that, let's say we have a first set of bylaws, there's always provisions in the bylaws to change it.
Yeah.
So if they don't work... You know, because sometimes you can spend a lot of time on that, time that maybe you could be spending on other issues that are important to the community. And this is from somebody that's not on that committee.
I think it's an important perspective to have. I have seen organizations get too bogged down in minutia with regards to bylaws and paint themselves into a corner. We actually start talking about discussion item number six, which are the officers for the committee. Just, again, this is going to be one of the things that I would like to make sure is on the next agenda, next month's agenda, to vote on, right? Who your officers will be, and what process you will use to identify those officers, those nominees for that, what the terms will be. Those are some of the basic things, but I think the four of you can sort of work out those details, and then come to the next meeting prepared to make a recommendation with regards to the language of the bylaws. And what I would love to see is to be able to share the draft that you come up with the rest of the committee so that everybody walks in prepared to think about it. One of the things that you need to think about is how frequently should this committee meet? And the other thing is, what time do you want this committee to meet? Because we've always met at 5:30 doesn't mean that we have to continue to meet at 5:30. What is the role, what is the appropriate role of the call to the audience? Where do you want the call to the audience to occur? Many of us who are in the public sector are familiar with that. For those of you who are not, have not been part of that previously, it's something that's maybe a little bit new. But I think those discussions are worth having. I think those things need to reflect your values as individuals, and need to be reflected in the bylaws. Before we move on to discussion item number seven, and as part of discussion items number five and six, one of the elements of the ordinance, it provides for the length of the terms of service, and it actually prescribes sort of a random process for selecting the length of the terms of service. I actually consulted with a county attorney a couple of weeks ago because I thought in the ordinance language we actually said at the first meeting. That's actually part of the reason why, and her advice to me was, Francisco, if this is an organizational meeting under the previous bylaws, you don't have to take that action yet. But understand that at the time that we vote on those next, that you vote on those next bylaws, there will be a process of selecting the length of terms for each of the members of this committee. And it prescribes it so that I believe the terms of 2 and 3 years.
Two
and 4 years. And they're meant to be staggered. And it's not to try to not have any, it's not to try to kick anybody out. It's going to be done at random here at the table. However, it is a process. The reason, the rationale for that is to make sure that we are infusing this group continuously with new ideas and new wisdom, as well as taking advantage of the established wisdom. So this was the way that we thought was the most Solomonic way of staggering the terms. So any questions about that?
I have a question about the bylaws, Dr. Garcia. When the committee puts them together and the board, when the subcommittee puts them together, and this committee votes on them, what is the process? I mean, does the county have to approve them, or does the lawyer have to approve them?
Ms. Hubbard, what I'm going to do is, when you provide the draft language for the bylaws, we will actually send it to the county attorney's office to make sure that there are no red flags. Having said that, for the most part, the county attorney provides a broad leeway in terms of what the actual content is. And as long as we're not proposing anything that's illegal or that's outside the scope of the ordinance, that will be the only kinds of things that she looks for. Dr. Smith?
I was appointed by our supervisors. I'm appointed from the Board of Health from a supervisor. It's an election year. If the supervisors change, they can then reappoint somebody. Does that mean we lose our position because they want somebody else to represent them on this committee or even on the Board of Health, which could take me off the Board of Health and then I'd be off this committee?
Dr. Schmidt, that's a very good question, and the answer is yes. You serve as political appointments. Those of you who serve as political appointments are vulnerable at the time that there is a changeover in that office, and we have ways of trying to promote the greatest degree of continuity. However, at the end of the day, a certain number of you serve at the pleasure of the appointing elected official. Other questions? Procedurally, the next item, number 7, is trying to think about what when the next meeting will be, specifically, and what kind of, and at least some initial guidance for the bylaws committee about what on what kind of regular what kind of regularity you want for these meetings. For instance, the Board of Health does this thing where effectively they meet 10 times a year about, and it allows them to sort of have a little bit of time during the holidays and a little bit of time during the summer. And that was up to the Board of Health to decide. I'm not going to make that suggestion to you, but I just want to express to you that there is leeway here in terms of what you want to do. There's also leeway in the way you want to manage your calendar, i.e. One of the things that you'll see is that we propose to have some kind of standing agenda items that would be carried from year to year. You know, we will always review enforcement, for instance, in January. We would always do adoptions in February, so that there are standing agenda items. I would propose, and I would propose that you would consider standing agenda items where you do a very deep dive into the specifics of what it is that we're doing at the Animal Care Center. And then there will be much more sort of topical kinds of things that are coming up as we do our daily business. I think we need to do both. We need to be able to look at the big picture from 30,000 feet, but we also need to be able to understand some of the operational details without ever sort of venturing into the position of providing oversight and management to the staff, but really understand some of the operational details so that you can be best informed. Questions?
Of course.
Ms. Hubbard.
I know we've gotten away from it, but I was hoping that we could get back to, with this new committee, getting a copy or knowing what the monthly statistics are as far as animals received, animals, you know, the no-kill or the life release rate, how many calls that our officers go out on, just some kind of information so that we have a picture of what is going on, you know, to reestablish that form or that process.
Ms. Hubbard, that would be a great item for the bylaw committee to say we want to create a dashboard of indicators and we want these kinds of indicators. Of course, it's going to need to be vetted with staff to figure out whether it's doable, and I'm sure that these things are. But I think that's a great agenda. That's a great item for the discussion with the bylaw committee, because I think you could sort of set something like that in the bylaw. Dr. Schmidt, Ms. Gillespie. Mr. Gillespie.
Well, to your point, I would advocate strongly that we continue to meet on a monthly basis.
Okay.
If possible. We have, I think Jose's presentation was testament to all the exciting things that we have coming in the future. And for us to accomplish what we all hope we can accomplish, I think we need that time to be working on things and moving forward, making recommendations.
And it certainly would not be a problem with us to support. We just want to make sure that you understand and you have the options. Dr. Smith?
Well, I agree with the monthly meeting, and I knew that the managers in the report that we had in the month, and the dangerous animals and the welfare cases that we discussed would be something I'd like to see continue, because it gives the committee an idea of what's going on in enforcement, as well as what's going on out in the community. I think that's important to have, whether we put that in the bylaws or whether that just becomes an agenda point on a monthly basis.
The idea of having kind of a set of dashboard indicators that you could sort of quickly look at, but maybe not spend hours delving into in detail unless you so chose, I think is a great idea. And that way you can sort of track, oh, this is what intake for us is this month versus next month. What are the things that are driving intake? What are the things that are driving calls? And then it could provide enough leeway to our staff, to our professional team at PAC, to say, and this is the easiest way for us to present that data to you, or this is how we think the data needs to be structured. But you could identify the items you want on that dashboard, then our job would be to come up with a way of interpreting that. Now, Jose, I'm going to lean on you to tell me whether I'm completely off my rocker or whether that would be something that would be doable and acceptable with our staff.
It is doable.
Other comments? Do folks have in terms of identifying the next meeting date, that is one of the things that we need to leave today with. Do folks want to keep this same time next month? Do folks want to have the same date or an alternate date or a different time? I would love to sort of get some closure from you on that, at least for the next meeting, and then we could sort of also include some of that as part of the bylaw subcommittee discussion.
Dr. My schedule is pretty open, so whatever the rest of you all occupy.
Does it tend to be the fourth Thursday?
Third Thursday.
We're bumped out, that's right, we're on the email on that. Okay, that's not bad. I have a small minority women's business commission meeting right prior to this for the city council, and that gets a little long on occasion, so there you go.
The other thing is, do you want this meeting to occur in the evenings as it is does currently, or would you like this to be a midday meeting or a morning meeting? One of the considerations that we are taking into account, quite honestly, under the Fair Labor Standards Act, a lot of our folks are being reclassified, and the staff that support this committee are staff that are non-exempt, and therefore, I would love it if it was during regular business hours, but we will absolutely accommodate you. If you think that that is the best time to conduct business, we will accommodate your ability to conduct business at the time that you think is appropriate. But I do want you to think about that, too.
We can certainly be, sorry, Greg, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I just had a question of Jose, Dr. Garcia. In years past, what has been our draw in terms of public concern, because I know some don't, but that would be my only thought. I'm open to any time, I won't adjust my schedule, but I want to make sure that the public that has an interest has an opportunity to attend as well.
Our meetings have been very well attended historically. Our meetings are more attended when there are controversial issues that are either happening in our community, and those of you who have served on this committee will correct me. They're much more well attended when there are controversial issues happening in the committee. However, having said that, whenever PAC does anything, we get an incredible draw. When we've done midday events, we get an incredible draw. So I think it's more maybe Ms. Hollinger, Mr. Gillespie, other folks at the table thinking about reaching out to your stakeholders, to the people who you talk to say, gosh, would a midday meeting completely mess things up for you, or should we continue on an evening meeting?
Is there an opportunity for this body to hold, in a sense, almost a public hearing if an issue was that controversial, where we could create an additional meeting for sort of a call to the audience opportunity? Because that, I'm very sympathetic to the staff pressures that
yes.
You all are under. We have the same challenge, and that's why we hold so many of our boards and commission meetings right during the end hours of the day, 3 to 5 kind of slot and that kind of thing. So one of the ways we get around that on occasion is holding that extra meeting for the sake of community input.
Mr. Squire, I think that could be something that could be built into the bylaws. And I will check with if that ends up being the bylaw recommendation, the recommendation in the bylaw, I will check with the county attorney and make sure. I believe that would be acceptable. I don't see that as being a big issue, but obviously I need to check it with the county attorney's office. Dr. Schmidt.
I know it's a little far down the line, but once the new building is completed, will we be able to move our meetings back to PAC? I think that's really important to have our meetings at PAC for the community, for the volunteers, and for the staff who come and talk to us.
Dr. Schmidt, that is so super important. One of the nice things is that we have a multi-use room. I think we call it multi-use room. Multi-purpose room, NPR, that you'll see on the plans. That's actually meant to be the room where we hold that. It is a little bit smaller than this, but it opens out into a courtyard so that if we had overflow, and if the weather was good, of course, we could have overflow into a courtyard. So yes, I agree with you completely. Right now, accommodating traffic and parking and just our operational challenges are just not doable. But that is the goal, with the goal still in our brains at in terms of the health department's leadership. And I believe the deputy county administrator, we still believe that we will be in at the end of 2017.
I would offer, Dr. Smith and Dr. Garcia, if we could occasionally have these meetings, especially if they're going to be monthly, in other parts of the city, where the city of Tucson certainly would have facilities where we could hold these in some of our parks throughout the city, because people don't know what this group does. It's one of the reasons that I'm sitting here. It's, you know, it's the magic money bit. They're just throwing money away over there. They're not throwing money away. But that's been that's been kind of the argument, right, in other parts of the community, not doing the day-to-day. So I absolutely agree with you. I think it's great to hold it in PAC, but I also think it'd be great to probably hold one maybe up in the Oro Valley area, out on the east side of Tucson. Give people the opportunity. If they don't come, so be it. But it gives people a chance as we move forward.
That's the kind of thing that could show up very easily on a bylaw.
Yes,
I could. And the language would be something like, you know, a meeting will be held in each one of the jurisdictional entities, you know, and you could schedule it. I mean, that's the kind of thinking that we need as we just stop our work. Other thoughts?
I was just going to say, you know, in terms of flexibility, I think you can put it in the bylaws to allow us to redirect meetings to different times if there are significant issues on the agenda, and just go from there.
For the purposes of the next meeting, are we agreed that this time slot is adequate for at least the folks that are around the table? We are missing Ms. Pina, we are missing Ms. Drewby. And the person who will be appointed in Dr. Hayes' slot. So we're clearly missing three important people from the table. But at the very least, can we say for the next meeting, this time slot works?
So are we talking the third Thursday or the fourth Thursday?
What would be your preference, third Thursday or fourth Thursday?
Third.
Third is still better, even though the Thursday is weird and short. September 1st is a Thursday. Kind of a short month. Works better for you all?
I think it either. It doesn't matter. I mean, you want to
technically, there's five Thursdays. That's
right. Do we want to do it on Thursday?
Right, that's the other piece.
Yeah.
You know, is there a better way?
We had our
1 week, the architect meeting here was on a Friday. I didn't think Friday evening, I didn't think anybody was going to show up. This place was bursting. I mean, we took down the, you know, wall there.
Yeah.
So I think you guys get to decide what day. If there's a better date, we're happy to accommodate it. I just needed a date for the next meeting, and then you'll build it into your bylaws.
Pam, I would suggest that we just do what we're doing.
Yeah.
For the next one. Okay.
Third.
So 15th.
Yep.
The 15th at 5 o'clock, 5:30.
5:30.
Okay. And is this a good location for now?
Yeah.
Okay. Excellent. So I wanted to make sure that we got Mr. Ekstrom out to and Yvette, and we are, because I know that he has something really important to do. The fundraiser for the scholarship in Washington, isn't it? In Washington. So please feel free to excuse yourself. I'm going to start the call today.
Oh, I thought you were going to treat us all to dinner.
You treat us all to dinner. Right? So I just wanted to give you an opportunity because I know that that's important. But if it's okay with everyone, we will do the call to the audience. Do we have name slips that have been turned in?
Yes.
So the call to the audience, for those of you who are not familiar with it, is a formal way of soliciting the feedback and commentary of our community colleagues.
Excuse me, if I could, please. But I'll be back.
Excellent.
Thank you. We still have a quorum.
Yep.
For those of you who are new to the process of the call to the audience, the call to the audience is a way of receiving some unfiltered feedback from our stakeholders. It is not an opportunity for us to engage in dialogue with them. That is part of the rules of the call to the audience, i.e. We can't respond to their specific issues. However, this is a really important time for me. It has served me well as an opportunity to listen to what people are saying and identify who it is that I need to do follow-up with. That's how I use call to the audience. On the citizen side of the call to the audience, it's a relatively brief statement. We're giving people 3 minutes. It's hard for people to sort of get all their issues out. But I think it becomes really important for us to start the conversation. So unless you have any other questions, I'm going to start the call to the audience. So the first person, and I'll ask you to come up here. The first person whose name was submitted was Ms. Marcy Bailey. She was at 5201 West Cayamontos. Welcome, Ms.
Thank you. Should I sit down?
Please, submit.
Hi, Marcy Bellin, and I'm with Noakville, Pima County. And I'd like to, welcome the newbies and really, really thank everybody, the newbies and the oldies, the goodies, for coming back and contributing to the discussion. Something so important to me and obviously important to you guys, if you wouldn't be here. I wanted to try and plant a few seeds, very big, basic, general seeds for areas of focus for the future for you to ponder, if you don't mind. We're getting close to no-kill, no-kill status, and there's many ways of defining what a no-kill shelter is, and when we use the term, we define it as saving the savable. Those that are treatable, those that can be rehabilitated, there'll always be a need for humane euthanasia. We know it's not 100% safe, but it's not a magic number, though 90% is one of the national indicators that are used a lot. But when we use the term, we're really looking at what can we do for this animal that they can live, and we pull it off. So as we get closer to that, it gets harder. We're looking at the minutia at this point, the fine-tuning. I mean, our organization is really proud of this county and this committee and how far we've come in the last, really, just 3-4 years. It's a miracle. It's not a miracle. I knew it all the time. but this is the hard part, and not only is this the hard part, but once you achieve, I think that's even harder for a couple reasons. But one, first to say, when you're looking at the data, if that's something that's going to be done on a regular basis, that I would hope and request that one of the things we focus on is who is left that's savable, what are the remaining challenges, because we're narrowing down to few numbers on a daily basis, but we can't help them if we don't know who they are. It's always been our way of looking at this, is who are they, and then we'll figure out how to help them. So to look at the data, and to include that in those indicators that are asked for, when we achieve no-kill, people think now it's great to bring animals to the shelter. When you move into a new shelter, and we have to really be proactive. There's going to be an influx. Your intake is going to go through the roof as much as you can, unless you just stop intake. I don't know if we'll be at that point again, you know, but whenever there's a brand new shelter, people are more comfortable leaving their animals. And when you have a bigger shelter, not that this one's that much bigger, but they'll think of it as that much bigger, even if it's not. And, oh, there's more room now, and there's going to be really, the challenges will be huge. I think in 2017, to maintain the no-kill rate that we might have at that point, as well as just managing the massive increase, I think would say. So to be proactive and to be thinking about that soon, about what's that going to look like and how are we going to manage it and handle it, I think would be great. I'd like to hope you keep the call to the audience. I know that's an option, it's not mandatory, and probably better in the evening. Although I think it's amazing, we do know people come out when it's important, but probably better in the evening for the citizens, I think, in general.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Marcy, and you were right at 4 minutes. Our next speaker is Ms. Jane Shireen from 3201 East Arroyo Chico. Please, Ms. Shireen, if you could come up close to the table, just so that you can...
Okay, I'll try.
Just so that you can have an opportunity to be heard well.
Yes.
You also have 4 minutes.
I'm speaking today about the tie-out law, which is one of the most important and most frequently used laws to help animals that the Animal Care Center is enforcing. And I just want to respectfully call your attention, and especially to the leaders of the Animal Care Center, and also to Mr. Ritchie, two important points about the tie-out law. And because at the last meeting, it was mentioned that some behaviorists are going to be called in to discuss what animals in distress or animals on a tie-out are suffering. And I want to call your attention to the fact that the law has answered this question, and it's not a matter of opinion, it's a matter of law. In the Pima County Ordinance, section 6.04.130 says, an animal is deemed to be in distress and subject to removal and impoundment if it is on a tie-out. So this is not a matter of opinion, it's a matter of law. I'll read it again. An animal is deemed to be in distress and subject to removal and impoundment if it is on a tie-out. That's Pima County Code 6.04.130. Then in the Tucson City Code, section 4-11 says, an animal is deemed to be in distress if it is on a tie-out. So I'll read it again. An animal is deemed to be in distress if it is on a tie-out. So that it's not a matter of opinion, and on this point, we don't need to consult behaviorists. The laws have already decided this point. And I only bring it up because I want these animals to be rescued away from the conditions that are causing them to be in distress. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Shireen. That was 3 minutes, that was perfect. Thank you very much. The next agenda item is the summation of action items, and this is something that we do in the Board of Health. You can decide whether this is a process that's useful, because it may not be, or it may be useful. That is, we just verbally, quickly go through everything that was done and make sure that everybody has clarity. So we started off by doing the introduction of the committee members. That was item number 3. Item number 4 was a PowerPoint that will be made available to all of you if you have not already received it. Michael will send it out individually to you because I think it's an important educational piece for you. Item number 5, we talked about establishing the committee bylaws and specifically identified a subset of 4 individuals, Andy, Barry Gillespie, Gail, and Pat. As the subcommittee that would be charged with authoring the bylaws. They will work with Marcy Flanagan, the deputy director in my office, and will work offline to be able to bring back a document for this committee to vote on. We also discussed the meeting schedule. We discussed the potential need to revisit who and what kind of officers would be useful to you. Item number 7, we discussed the meeting schedule, and the only thing that was decided firmly was that the next meeting would be would be
September
15th at 5:30 at this location. And then we concluded with a call to the audience and had comments from NoFilk, as well as from Ms. Dejerine and local animal advocate. So is there any other item that I forgot to include in the summation? So if it's okay with you, seeing if, unless there's any objection, I would like to have us adjourn at 7:01. Our first meeting, PAC Act 2.0.
Really quickly, can you forward the summation to us?
Absolutely.
I find that very helpful.
Absolutely. I'll make sure that the minutes, which memorialize the summation, get to you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, and I look forward to a productive meeting next month.
Great.